We've been warned about the dangers of high cholesterol and E. coli from eating meat and chicken, but less known is the danger posed to the environment. That's right, the environment. Studies show climate change and water shortages are directly linked to the amount of meat we consume. According to a recent film, animal agriculture is responsible for 65% of nitrous oxide emissions. That's a greenhouse gas with nearly 300 times the global warming potential of carbon dioxide. And there's more. It's all the subject of an environmental documentary called Cowspiracy. Later, we'll talk with the person behind the film, but first, here's an excerpt.
In 2009, two advisors from the World Bank released an analysis on human-induced greenhouse gases, finding that animal agriculture was responsible not for 18%, as the UN stated, but was actually 51% of all greenhouse gases. 51%. Yet all we hear about is burning fossil fuels. This devastating figure is due to clear-cutting rainforests for grazing, respiration, and all the waste animals produce. This makes animal agriculture the number one contributor to human-caused climate change. But not only that, I found out raising animals for food consumes a third of all the planet's fresh water, occupies up to 45% of the Earth's land, is responsible for up to 91% of Amazon destruction, is a leading cause of species extinction, ocean dead zones, and habitat destruction. Yet, the world's largest environmental groups that are supposed to be saving our world didn't mention this anywhere.
Joining us now from San Francisco is the co-writer, co-producer, and narrator of Cowspiracy, Kip Andersen. And with us from The Hague, where she serves as a leader in parliament, is the first elected member of the Party for the Animals, Marianne Thieme. Thanks to both of you for joining us. Kip, as you point out in that documentary, Cowspiracy, we hear a lot about the role of fossil fuels in climate change, but really about the role of meat and dairy farming in climate change. Why is that the case?
The big case is a lot of it is that the environmental groups that should be telling us this, they're not telling us this. And it's something that people just don't really want to hear. It's very easy. I just got back from Paris, and it's very easy to rally against fossil fuels, say no to climate change, but when it really has a direct effect on what they can do on a daily level, individual level, which is stop consuming animal products, meat and dairy, that's something that people just do not want to hear. So it's not technically a win campaign, so you just don't hear about it.
And the reason these big environmental groups are not telling us about it is what? Because they don't know or because they don't want to tell us about it?
Most of them do know, actually. They do know. It's been well documented, and it's a very easy Google search. Again, what it is, it's they're more concerned about the sustainability and the growth of their own organization than they are sustainability about the planet. They take precedence over themselves of as an organizations. So it's not considered a win campaign. Again, it's not something that people want to hear, so they don't want to tell them. So it's essentially, if you have lung cancer, it's a doctor saying, I'm not going to tell you that it's cigarette smoking in fear of you might go to another doctor, when in reality of the case is that you have to tell the people this because it's such an urgent, important information that people just have to know.
Marianne, you are a member of parliament in the Netherlands, where you founded the world's first political party for the rights of animals. You know, we know that there are many people around the world who fight for the rights of animals, but there you are. You're a member of parliament representing the rights of animals in a national parliament. This is a first. How did that happen?
Well, animal rights and animal welfare and nature and climate have long been a side dish for a few traditional political politicians who were willing to defend it. But it was a key issue for those traditional politicians who thought that animal welfare and an environment is just high-priced nonsense. So in 2002, when the government at that time just wiped away animal welfare issues and environmental measures just off the table as swiftly as possible, we thought a party for animals would serve the discussion about whether or not we should rethink our position in the world, the humans as the center of all, instead of putting the planet first and all its inhabitants. So we started the party for the animals. And a lot of people thought, well, this is really a good joke. What's next? A party for plants, a party for bicycles. But there were also opinion leaders and actors and writers who thought that it's a next logical step in the emancipation movement after the liberation of slaves, giving rights to women and children. The next logical step is to give rights to animals and to put the planet first.
Well, our people have clearly taken you very seriously because you're now sitting in Parliament. Kip, if we look at factory farming, meat factory farming, and if we look at how dangerous it is, as you point out in your documentary, for the environment, for the future of the planet, what's the alternative? Do we abandon meat completely? I mean, is there a way of producing meat and dairy products that is not so damaging?
There really isn't. And the big reason is that around 100 years ago, when there was only around 1.5 million people, at that time, there possibly could be. But right now, we're close to 7 billion people, growing to 9 billion people, and the demand for meat and dairy has grown so exponentially that there's just no room for it. And ironically, factory farm is for a sustainability level due to land use is actually more sustainable than, say, grass-fed or pasture-raised livestock. And because the reason why is it takes so much more land to produce meat and dairy in these quote sustainable tactics like free roaming, grazing, grass-fed. In reality, that's what's destroying all our wildlife and is actually putting more methane into the air. So there's really no way around it. And you'll hear a lot of these stories that they think there will be, but not with 7 billion people of demand on meat and dairy.
Marianne, as Kip points out, there isn't that much awareness, let's say in the United States, in other parts of the world as well, on the dangers of animal farming. Is that the case in Europe as well?
Well, when we started with our documentary Meet the Truth in 2007 as an addendum to The Inconvenient Truth of Al Gore, the State Secretary of Agriculture said it was one big lie and asked our University of Agriculture in Wageningen to check the figures. And after 3 months of hard calculation, they stated that it was true that the meat industry caused so much greenhouse gas emissions. But the fact is that when you try to have a debate on meat consumption in a parliament, also in the European Parliament, where we also represent it, the politicians, but also the journalists, really do not want to take it seriously. I think it hits them personally. It's like a human basic right to kill animals and to eat them, and that you want to touch that. And that has to change. And what we see now in Holland, for example, is that not more than 20% of all the Dutch eat meat on a daily basis. So it's really changing rapidly that people think it's healthier and it's sustainable to eat less meat. So it's a trend. And it's a hopeful trend, but on the other side, you see, of course, that in India and China, the meat consumption is really rising very fast. So we have to show those people that meat as a status, a symbol of wealth, is not really realistic at this moment, and that a healthy diet is a real status symbol of the 21st century.
Kip, I watched the documentary, and one of the things that struck me was the level of resistance that is quite evident in the documentary from international environmental organizations. I mean, you tried to interview a lot of them. You wrote emails, you made telephone calls, you got nothing back. Some of them ultimately did grant you an interview, but you get an organization like Greenpeace that said, no, we're not going to talk to you at all. Why do you believe there was such reluctance on the parts of these organizations not to talk with you?
Because that's what's interesting and almost comedic about these interviews, what people love about the film, if it wasn't such a serious topic, is that, again, it goes back to a win campaign. They want to hear. They want to give what people want to hear, and what people want to hear is these abstract, say no to fossil fuels, reduce oil content, don't do palm oil, and all these different things are very important. But essentially, I compare it to, say, a house is burning, so relative a house to a planet, and the house is burning, and you have a bonfire in the middle of the house, which is called animal agriculture, and these organizations are coming in and saying, oh, the windows needs to be polished, or there's a leaky faucet, and they're doing all these individual things that are important, but meanwhile, in the middle, there's a huge bonfire that nobody wants to talk about because it's not going to help their organization. It's not going to help Greenpeace get their donorship. It's not going to help Sierra Club or the Rainforest Action Network to increase their donorship for people to jump on board and give them money. So they just don't want to talk about it. It's a taboo subject because it might offend or or not be good for their campaigns. Not only that, though, a lot of these organizations, the heads of organizations, are contributing to this environmental damage by themselves eating meat and dairy, and they have crossover with their top funders, cross-pollinating, if you will, into their board of directors and infiltrating these organizations.
Marianne, I want to get back to what you just said a moment ago about the fact that, you know, the consumption of meat is seen in many countries, many developing countries, as a status symbol, countries like India and Pakistan, India and China, as you've pointed out. But here's something else. There are critics who say that meat consumption is an integral part of human culture. They see meat is essential to nutrition, especially in poorer developing countries. Do they have a point at all?
Well, that's a very old-fashioned view, in my opinion. We already know the relationship between red meat and cancer. We already know that, especially in the Western world, people eat 30% too much protein coming from animal products, and that causes a lot of obesity problems and diabetes. So we really have to change our diet also for healthy reasons. It's an old-fashioned way of thinking.
Kip, here's a contrarian view. There's an organization called the Union of Concerned Scientists. It's a respected organization. They issued a report in 2011, and they said that there are ways of producing beef which are climate friendly, and these ways would actually reduce methane and nitrous oxide emissions. The US EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, also said recently that agriculture is responsible for 10% of emissions, well below the energy and transportation sectors, which are responsible for 32 and 28% respectively. To which you would say what?
Those numbers, especially the 10% and the 32, what you're seeing there is it's kind of cherry picking what you want to leave in and take out. So a lot of that transportation cost, they're not figuring out that a lot of that, the transportation cost goes into feeding 70 billion animals. So all this feed, all the soy, 90% of all soy goes to feed these animals, cross countries, across even in different continents. And so that's one of those things that doesn't come into play. They're just talking about emissions, say, just from the cow. So what they're doing is, again, they're cherry picking for the industry to make it look as good as possible. And the thing about these numbers is they like to get people have a little bit of confusion of doubt whether it's 10% or 18% or 51%. So they will sway your focus into not realizing not only is it climate change and greenhouse gases, but it's also the leading cause of species extinction, rainforest destruction, water consumption, water depletion, and the list goes on and on and on. They get focused on, oh, what number is it? So we just have to look at the entire picture that this industry is destroying every single issue when it comes to environmental damage.
Marianne, very quickly, do you see more support for a political party like yours? Are we going to see more politicians like yours get into national parliaments?
Well, we've got already 50 politicians now in Holland, but also one in the European Parliament. And we're a very successful export product, as I can say, of the Dutch export product. There are already 15 parties for the animals in the world, also in the Senate, for example, in Australia, in New South Wales, but also in Portugal. There's one, a humane party in the US. So you see that's a growing resistance of people who really want to change things. And it's also very, I think, a happy thought that the fork and knives are our powerful weapons against climate change. You can change your diets very easily. For example, if all Americans eat just one day without meat, that would mean the same greenhouse gas emissions savings of putting 19 million cars off the US roads. So I think that's very easy to do for everybody. So I think that's a good message.
That's right.